Welcome to the Jamestown First Baptist Church Worship Hour. Established in 1930, the First Baptist Church has been instrumental in spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ across the Cumberland Mountains. An aggressive local missions program has assisted in establishing sister churches in Fentress County, the Pickett State Park area, and Morgan County. With programs to minister to the individual and the family, we invite you to join with us in our live worship service.
Well, good morning. We're glad you're here today. And as we begin the service today, I just want to say that this begins the week of prayer for the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. And I want to ask you to look at the monitors for a few moments, a while, as we'll be having a video for about a minute and a half, just introducing you to the Annie Armstrong. So please pay attention. You have in your handout this morning a little prayer guide for the week. This is the week of prayer for Annie Armstrong. The goal for the church is $4,000. And you can pick up an envelope, and we encourage you to give through this month as we try to reach that goal for home missions here in our own country. If you are a guest today, we are glad you're here. Today's a special day in the life of First Baptist Church of Jamestown. But today is Deliverance Day, and you know that... We know that the Lord can break addictions and deliver us from all the things that we face. And I tell people this, we all battle addictions. I battle the addiction of chocolate, you know, but we all do struggle in life. And I don't make that to be flippant, but just to say it is a day to remind us that our Lord does deliver us, and we are so thankful for His grace and His mercy and goodness. Let me encourage you to be in your place of service this week. After the morning service, if you would like to stay for lunch, there is a lunch provided, so you are invited to stay and be a part of that immediately following the morning service. So please, you'll be back. If you're a guest, go down the steps and back to your left and into the gym, and there are tables set up, and we'll be having lunch right there. So please keep that in mind. Just encourage you to be in your place of service, the opportunities that God gives to you. At this time, Brother Bill is going to come, lead Scripture, and share with us.
Good morning.
Good morning.
This morning's Scripture comes from Matthew 16, verses 13 through 16. When Jesus came upon the region of Caesarea Philippi, He asked His disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Will ushers come forward, please? Okay. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for each of the blessings. Thank you for the sunshine. And dear Father, thank you for all that's gathered here in your house. And dear Father, we thank you for your Son Jesus that saved our souls on the cross. Now dear Father, we ask that you bless the gift and the giver for the ongoing of your work. This we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
One thing, we'll say congratulations to one of our high school teams. Clark Rains is going to the state. Give him a hand. Kara, we'll be rooting for you up there. By the way, Kara, we studied about you in science. You know what we studied? There are such things as an immovable force. I hear an amen? All right, let's stand. We're going to praise God today.
Wonder.
Greet each other in the name of the Lord. Wired, so if I get shot. They said I was always wired. We are more than conquerors through our risen Lord. Today we're kind of honoring some of our special guests from Manor House. And I tell you what, we all have chains that we have to break. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's all stand. We're going to praise Him today. Manor House, this is for you. If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you've got pain, He's a pain taker. If you feel lost, He's a way maker. If you need freedom or saving, He's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light day in the dead of our lives. We've all
He's a pain taker. You feel lost. He's a way maker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker.
There is power.
Cause I'm no longer slave.
Know this chorus, sing with me. I'm a child of the King. A child of the King. With Jesus my Savior. I'm a child of the King. I believe that, say amen.
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 Good morning. Can you hear me? Not well? Can you hear me? All right. I had to scoop the bench up. My legs are a little shorter than my dad's. So. All right, here we go. You can't play with us. You're not cool enough. Your skin, your hair, and then your clothes. You won't amount to much. Just look at where you come from. That's what they said, but they didn't know. You opened my eyes and helped me to realize that's not my identity. That's not what you say of me. What's written in your word means more to me than what I've heard. That's not who I am, but on the was a time I believed those lies. Then I started to compromise, just trying to fit in this world. I was chasing worldly dreams and the cover of magazines, but it was too much for this girl. I'm not what I do. That's not my identity. That's not what you say of me. What's written from your son means more to me than what I've done. That's not who I am. On the word of God, I'll take my stand and I'll put my faith in the one. I'm blameless, I'm accepted, and the beloved. I'm righteous, I'm forgiven. Now that's what I'm believing. I'm seated in higher places, and I'm dwelling where all the grace is. And I'm more than a conqueror in Christ. That's my identity. That's what you say of me. What's written in your word means more to me than what I've heard. Well, that's just who I am. what you say of me.
I'm getting ready to introduce the speaker this morning while the choir goes down. This is someone that I believe from the bottom of my heart has broken chains. Unbelievable. He's a former welterweight boxing champ. He still couldn't handle me, but he could. He never could catch me. But as the choir goes down, I just want to tell you how much I appreciate my son-in-law and my daughter and my precious, beautiful grandkids that's here today. So, just going to turn it over to Anthony, a godly.
How y'all doing today? My name is Anthony Brent Cooper. I'm going to share with you today about the chains he's talking about being broken. I really met God back in about 2002. I got saved as a kid, but I grew up an idiot. And like she was saying about in the world, I was chasing the worldly dreams, and I really started getting into drinking and drugs when I in my teenage years and 20s. I feel the presence of God, so I get a little teary-eyed, but bring out my boxing. I got a shadow box, warm up a little bit, get that inner sissy out of me. But I really met God back in about 2002. I didn't meet him in church like a lot of people do. I was headed out west to pick up a lot of marijuana. A friend of mine had started selling drugs, and he was making a lot of money doing it. So that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be famous. I wanted to be rich. I thought this is where your happiness was. And so I would drive out west, pick up the drugs, take it back to him, and he would sell it. One time I decided that I was going to meet God. I wanted, you know, I'd heard about God. I grew up, and I'd be out snorting cocaine, hitting people, telling you I knew Jesus. And I'd be preaching to you, and if you didn't agree, we're going to fight. You know, it's just the way I was, and I was an idiot. But I went on a fast, and I decided I wanted to meet God, because I thought if I had God on my side with what I was doing, you know, I'm cool, you know. And so I went on a fast, and I met God. And it wasn't like the God that I kind of heard up as a kid. You know, I heard about going to hell a lot, you know, because that's probably where I was headed. But I met the God of the new covenant. You know, 1 John 4:8 says God is love. John 4:24 says God is a spirit. I met the spirit of love. And it was the most overwhelming presence of forgiveness, peace, freedom. Chains were broke. In that sense. But, you know, of course you don't become Billy Graham overnight. You know, took me a couple weeks. But but I got out there to the people that I was getting the drugs from, and I was like, I've met God. I've met God. I mean, I was just so excited. But you've been in the presence. You know, God's a spirit, and he's in the presence of love. And I mean, I was just overwhelmed. And they were just like, you got to go. I'm getting drugs from these people, and they're just like, this dude's a nut. But I just didn't care, man. I was just telling everybody about Jesus, that he loves us. And I got home, and a friend of mine gave me a book called Wild at Heart by John Eldridge. I mean, it was just like, this book was talking right. It was like a psychiatrist in a book. He was just reading my mail. This was just God. And I just read that book, and I was just so on fire for God. But I was still, you know, an idiot in the head, you know, because that's a process. You get saved, you're a baby. But I mean, I was just out there still. I was still going out west and just thinking, man, I'm getting all this money. Now I'm like the modern day drug dealing Robin Hood, man. I can help everybody. I go into restaurants, you know, give them my bill be 20 bucks. I give them 50. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. I'm just throwing money around all crap. I'm just like, God loves me. Well, of course, you know, I got caught because you can't be an idiot forever. And, when I got arrested, it was one of the most freeing times of my life because my whole life was a lie. I was lying to everybody. And after shadow box again. I didn't have to do it no more. God started a healing process in my life. As we started putting my marriage together, because we never had a marriage before. We both lived just two separate lives. Like she said, we was chasing the worldly dreams. We didn't know how to be married. We were just out there. He started putting our marriage together. And I read a book called Purpose Driven Life by Rick Warren. And it was about, you know, just a 40-day journey. And this is like the first thing that we ever really truly did together, my wife and I. And it's kind of like that love dare thing, I guess, that they had with years ago. And so we just started doing this book together and stuff. And then I was like, we need a church. I need a church, you know. And so we got a flyer in the mail from a local church not too far from our house. So I was like, well, we'll try this out. My dad had just died in January. And I was also at this time, I was getting ready to go on a reality show called The Contender with Sylvester Stallone and Sugar Ray Leonard. So I had a lot of stuff going on. I'm going to prison. Dad just died. I'm going on national television. And I've been sober now for about 2 weeks. So I had a lot going for me. So, because the last time that I got drunk, and I remember this, I was 29 years old. And so and I was downtown. I was with George Strait's manager. And I woke up in an alley. And I was like, they took me to like a drunk tank or something. I'm out on bond from out west. I'm in the drunk tank, and this is the first time I ever told. I was like, I can't stop. I got a problem. I can't quit. And I never would have said that before. I was so full of pride. I didn't care. When I was young, I was like, man, I've never smoked pot till I smoked pot. I would never do cocaine till I did cocaine. And I was like, I'd never do that. And I was like, I don't care. I'll do anything. Nothing. You know, because I was just so full of pride, just so full of darkness. I said, I can't stop. I need help. So we started that church, and the day we walked in that church, the pastor was doing a skit about Rocky. I'm getting ready to go on a show with Sylvester Stallone. Who is Rocky? I'm like, this is God. This is God. I mean, I was just like, oh my gosh. And so I joined the church that night, and just totally got immediately involved, got baptized in the Holy Spirit. I've been sober now this May. It will be 13 years I've been sober, drug-free, everything. And after that, but my pastor started teaching me about the Word of God. This is where the transforming power comes. It says in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. Do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The way that we present our bodies to God is not just by coming to church every week. That's good. And I mean, you know, the Bible says don't forsake the assembly of the saints. That's great to come to church. But hear what the pastor says. Renew your mind to what the Word of God says. Hebrews 4:12 says the Word of God is quick, alive, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing the soul and the spirit. You want those chains broken? You want all that? You got to renew your mind. You got to stay in the Word of God. And that's not just, you know, reading it and checking my mark, you know, like, I read the Bible today, God, you got to bless me. No, God's already done what he's going to do. Ephesians chapter 1 talks all about what God has done for us. Ephesians 1, he's blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly. He has, past tense. When Jesus died on the cross and said, it is finished, our deliverance was finished. Now it's up to us to get into agreement with him. And 2 Corinthians 6:1 says, we're workers with God. He works through his word, through the power of his word. So that's what I did. I was listening to what my pastor was saying. I listened to those CDs day in and day out. I encourage you, listen to what your pastor says. Renew, just listen to it. Listen to it. Start saying it out of your mouth. Saying that's how the transforming power is. Proverbs 18:21, death and life is in our tongue. And I would start taking this scripture, John 3:16. It's a new one. But it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And our pastor would say, he gave me a CD at the beginning in the little pack that they give it for the visitors. And it says, you don't have a health problem, you got a love problem. You don't have a money problem, you got a love problem. You don't have a fear problem, you got a love problem. You just don't know how much God loves you. And man, I could quote that, you know, and I could get drunk, snort coke, and tell you about that. But when you truly believe how much God loves you, that's where the power is. 1 John 4:18 says, perfected love cast out fear. And that's where, you know, we think of like the addictions and the drugs and all that stuff is the bad thing. But fear is at the top of the sin list in Revelation 20. Fear, because it all stems from that. So we got to break that fear. We got to get to the root instead of the fruit. We get to the root, it's that fear, not knowing how much God loves me.
I mean, it's taking that scripture right there. I would do like he said, for God so loved Anthony that he gave Jesus. For God so loved Anthony that he gave Jesus. I'd walk around saying that. I'd listen to those CDs. You'll get weird for a while. I'm still a little bit there, but at least I'm a little bit more, because you've got a battle going on the inside. The Bible says in Matthew 11:12, it says that the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. The violent take it by force. It ain't heaven up there. It's heaven in here. Luke 17:21, the kingdom of heaven is within you. When you make Jesus the Lord of your life, God comes to live on the inside of you. 1 John 4:4, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Colossians 1:27, Christ in me, the hope of glory. Galatians 2:20, it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Philippians 2:13, it's God working in me, both to will and to do it. The more you start saying it and you start meditating on that, that's where that power comes. Ephesians 6:10 says to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That's how you're doing it. By believing in what he says. Most people know, you know, they give the altar call in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. Says that we are saved by grace through faith, not of ourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Everybody say, woo! So we're saying, it's because we don't have to do nothing about it. It's a free gift because of what Jesus has done for that. And so Romans 10, 9 says, if you'll confess that Jesus is your Lord, believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Praise God. But that just starts it. Now we got to walk this out. We got a life to live. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says the devil is the god of the world system, blinding the minds of the people. He's coming at your mind. How do we get him out? By the word of God. By looking into the word of God. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 through 23. This is God's victory plan for any battle that you're in. He says, attend to my words. Incline your ears to my saying. Don't let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for their life to those that find them, health to all their flesh. It says, guard your heart, for out of it flow the issues of life. And so you guard your heart by what you see, by what you say, and what you hear, and who you're around. And especially if you're trying to get free from, like, drugs or addictions or just anything. Or like he said, chocolate, you know. Or I mean, there's dark chocolate that's good for you, though. But the healthy guy. But if you're trying to get, whatever you're trying to get free from, you can't be hanging around the same old people. You know, like our pastor says, and a lot of people say, you know, you show me your three closest friends, I'll show you you. Show me your three closest friends, I'll show you your future. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15, it says, evil company corrupts good habits. So, I mean, you might be a good person. You hang around about the wrong crowd long enough, you're going down. And that's exactly what the devil does. Mark chapter 4 says, he said the devil comes immediately to steal the word. And he's not the guy with the pitchforks and the horn. You know, it'd be cool if we could see him walk through the door, kick down. Oh, we know how to get him. But no, he's coming through anybody. He's coming at the minds. Just like when Peter, and Jesus said, no, Satan, get behind me, Satan. He comes at your mind. He's coming at their minds, and he's coming at you through different people. Hang around the wise, you'll be wise. Hang around a companion of fools, you'll be destroyed. So you hang around the right people, and if you don't have the right people to hang around, you get into YouTube, get some good hope, faith preachers, some love, you know, just listen to it. In and out, day in and day out. This is how you renew your mind. This is how you're transformed from the inside out. And that's what I did for hours and hours and hours. And I still do that. I mean, I drive a shuttle, and I got the headphones. I got preaching going on. And I'm talking to people, and I'm leading them to Jesus left and right. Just talking, telling them about Jesus. Well, anyways, after we started our church, started renewing my mind to God's word. God really started changing, started restoring my life. I went on that TV show, this is years ago, and I was on there talking about Jesus and what he had done in my life. And it was just so cool because it was on NBC, and there's all these guys just sitting around me, these fighters, and they were just sitting around just locked on me. And when I watched it, I was kind of taken back to it because I was just the presence of God on me. Man, I can't. If I'm not going to talk, you know, they're not just going to sit there and just like this. Especially some tough guys. We're getting ready to fight for $1 million, and they're wanting to kill me. So, you know, but it was just God. You know, and I got beat up pretty bad on the show, so I don't want to talk too much about that. But it's in the past. But God really started restoring my life, and he's opened up a lot of doors for us to preach and stuff. But I want to say to you guys, like, whatever it is that you're dealing with, maybe it's a divorce, maybe it is drugs, maybe you've lost somebody, or whatever, you can start over. There's a cool song that this guy sings that says, everybody got a bad page, everybody got a blank page, a story they're writing today, a wall that they're climbing, You can carry the past on your shoulders, or you could start over, regrets. No matter what you've gone through, Jesus gave it all to save you. He carried the cross on his shoulders so we could start over. He carried the cross. He carried your addiction. He carried your pain. He carried your hurt. He carried your guilt. He carried whatever it was. He carried it so you could start over. That's why you renew your minds and you receive that love. You receive what he did for you so you can start over. And I do got some notes. That's just the intro. It's my first time doing this. We might be here all day. But I want to encourage you. There is hope. There is hope. And there is a light at the end of the tunnel. And it's not an oncoming train. It's the Lord Jesus, the light of the world that takes away the sins of the world. Woo! Hebrews 11:1. This is where I was going. Where I started. Hebrews 11:1 says, now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. Hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. And that word hope in the original Greek language, in which I am a Greek scholar or a Google scholar, is the Greek word elpis. Elpis. And it means you ain't nothing but a hound dog. Crying all the time. Now, it's the Greek word elpis, and it means a confident expectancy. Our faith works when there's a confident expectancy that things can change, that it can get better. I don't have to stay in this pit. I don't have to be bound. Like the songs, the chains are broken. I don't have to. A confident expectation, that's where my faith works. Galatians 5:6 says that faith works by love. God loves me. I got a confident expectation that I don't have to, I can move forward. My life can be restored. I can have a happy family. I can have a successful life because God loves me. But it takes that hope. Jeremiah 29:11, it's up here. Great scripture. God did this just for me. But Jeremiah 29:11, for this is God speaking to you. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you, to give you a hope and a future, a confident expectancy of a future. Proverbs 4:18 says, the path of the righteous gets brighter and brighter. And if you've made Jesus the Lord of your life and you've received the gift of righteousness, not your own works, as Isaiah says, as filthy rags, but it's a gift of righteousness. My right standing with God based on what Jesus has done for me, my path's supposed to get brighter and brighter. So as I'm renewing my mind, I'm walking it out with Jesus. I'm not saying you don't have the challenges and the battles, but you've got the power of the Almighty God to overcome anything that comes at you. Like I said before, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence. It's going on, but you're the winner. You are more than a conqueror. You can do all things. You can break those chains. You can break those addictions. You have what it takes. Like I said, Ephesians 1, you're blessed, you're chosen, you're holy, you're righteous, you're accepted in the beloved. God is for you. It doesn't matter who's against you. Those chains are going to be broken. And that's how you just believe it and you walk it out. No, I'm working on something here. I'm working. God's got a good plan for my life. I'm working. I don't know. I'm reading my Bible. I'm not reading it to get brownie points with God. I've already got the whole brownie factory. I'm reading it because I'm seeing how much God loves me. I'm seeing how much God is for me, how he's going to change me. And that alive word's coming alive on the inside of me. He's working through me. He's for me. Oh, yay. Philippians 2:12 and 13. This is our part again. It says to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And that's not fear to be scared of, because the Bible says it knocks out fear. It's a reverential awe. With everything you got, we're going to work out that salvation. Don't work for it. Jesus did that. But we got to work it out. For it's God. Here's the good news. You're not doing it by yourself. For it's God working in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. It's his good pleasure when you succeed in life. It's his. And I'm not talking about worldly success. I'm talking about being a great husband. I'm talking about being a great parent. I'm like Earl and his family, great parents. That's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about raising up godly kids. I'm talking about... Woo! Shadowbox getting intercessory. I'm talking about doing it for Jesus and showing his glory. The Bible says in Colossians 1:27, Christ in me, the hope of glory. So Christ in me. And when God comes alive on the inside, you know, the Bible says in Isaiah, it talks about, you know, in the last days, it's going to get darker and darker. It says gross darkness is going to cover the earth. But the glory of the Lord is going to rise upon us as believers. People are going to be coming to us being like, why you got this peace, this joy? Don't you see the craziness? Let me tell you about Jesus. Let me tell you about Jesus, my Lord and Savior. He broke those chains for me. Now I can help you to break them too. I can teach you the Word of God. I can teach you. I can help you. I can mature you in the Word of God. And the Bible says in Philippians 3:10, it says, Paul wrote this. He says, for this one thing, he says, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection, that I may know God. And Paul, I mean, he started churches. He wrote books in the Bible. He did a lot. But the one thing, I want to know God and Jesus and the power of His resurrection. And that's the same thing for you and I. When you start knowing Him, this is how those chains can be broken. John 8:31 and 32 says, if you'll continue in my word, then are you my disciple. It's a follower, a learner. You'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. It's the truth don't make anybody free. It's the truth that you know and believe that makes you free. So I'm going to continue in that word. I'm going to see how to get free. I'm going to see the promises of God. 2 Corinthians 1:20, all the promises of God in Him are yes and amen. And He's given me divine promises. God is for me. James 4:7, I'm going to submit myself to God. I'm going to resist the devil, resist that evil company, resist that companion of fools. I'm submitting to God because I'm working on something. I'm working on freedom. I'm working on freedom. Galatians 6:9 says, don't grow weary in doing good, for in due season you will reap if you faint not. So you don't give up. You don't quit. You're more than conquerors. You can do all things through Christ which strengthens you. He that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. That's why you don't ever have to get up. And I think they've been talking about Romans chapter 5 through 8 here. I love the book of Romans. It's about grace and faith. And Romans 5:1 and 2 says that we're justified by faith. I'm justified just as if we've never sinned, by faith. And believing in what Jesus has done for us, by faith, we're justified. Romans 5:5 says that now hope does not disappoint. That confident Elpis, the hound dog, does not disappoint. For the love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. And it says in Romans 5:17, I got it up there. This is one of my favorite scriptures. I confess this all the time, renew my mind to this all the time, that I receive that abundance of grace. But it says, for if by the one man's offense, death reigned through the one, talking about Adam. And we all, and see, when we get to heaven, and Adam's up there, we all get one shot at him. I mean, it's heaven. It's heaven. But, I mean, he won't feel it like he should. But we get one shot. No, I truly believe he's in like protective custody. Because that's what people are thinking about when they're coming through that. It's like, they're just they won't hit him. And then it's like, now it's heaven. Now we can. But if by the one man's offense, death reigned through the one, much more, those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will rule and reign in life through the one Jesus Christ. You'll rule and reign over the addictions. You'll rule and reign over the hurt, over the past. That's why we can't change the past. But we got a choice to make in the future. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10 says that we are His workmanship. One translation says His masterpiece. That's my favorite. His masterpiece, created for good works, which He prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. That we should. That's why we got a choice to make, that we should walk in it. As we present our bodies to Him, we're renewing our minds, we're working out our salvation, and we start walking in that preordained path. And He's got the job for you. He's got the people for you to meet. He's got all it already planned for you. And that's when you come into agreement, because He's your Father, and He loves you. He don't want you to be bound by anything. He wants to show His glory through you. He is the chain breaker through His Word. Romans chapter 5 and verse 20 says, where sin abounds, grace much more abounds. And grace, is in the Bible, but it's just unmerited favor. It's undeserved access. Paul, 2 Corinthians 12:9, talks about when Paul went to God, and he's asking him to take the thorn from his flesh from him. So he went to him three times. And God said, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. Grace is God's power. It says it's made perfect in your weakness. And in other words, Paul, I've given you the power. You got what it takes. Acts 1:8, you'll receive that power that he's talking about. It's the same word in the Greek. You got the power. You got what it takes. And I'm telling you, you got the power. You got what it takes to overcome anything that this world brings. James 1:5, you lack wisdom, ask of God. God will give you the wisdom through you, and He'll show you what to do. John John 16:13, the Holy Spirit shows you things to come. This is a companionship. This is a fellowship. This is walking it out with God to overcome anything that you're dealing with. You know, and all this good news, is that's why, you know, Paul is preaching all this good news. And they said in Romans 6:1-2, it says, shall we continue in sin? You know, it's all taken care of. Jesus did it all for us, so we can just go ahead and live however we want to. And he's like, oh, no, certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? It says in Romans 6:16, to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slave whom you obey, whether to sin or to righteousness. If you want to live a miserable, defeated, empty life, go ahead. God loves you. You're going to have a miserable life. But you submit yourself to the righteousness of God. 1 Corinthians 15:34 says, awake to righteousness. In everyday language, awake to who you are. You are a child of the Most High God. You don't want to live that life. You got too high of a calling. You got too important of a life. You got too many, maybe you're older in your life. You got people that can look to you as mentors. You got these other generations that you can raise up. And maybe everybody in your family's been crazy at one time. You can break the chain. Man, I grew up like that. Man, but you can break the chain. You can be the first one to start a new generation for your kids and their kids and kids, 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 and all down the line. You can do it. You're the one. You're chosen. You didn't choose him. He chose you and called you. And it says, and I'm getting through this pretty good. It says in Romans 3:23, talking about, should we just go ahead and sin because we can, you know. Romans 3:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You want to be spiritually dead? go on. The choice is yours. And it says in Romans 7:15, this is Paul going on. I'm getting through this whole book right here. Paul's talking about, you know, the things I do, I don't want to do, but it's not me doing it. And, you know, something. And used to, I think, man, Paul can't get free. How in the world am I going to get free? You know, he's Paul. But it says, he goes on to say, he had a revelation. Oh, I thank my God, the Lord Jesus. That's who can deliver me from this wretched man that I am. The Lord Jesus can. And the Lord Jesus can with you as well. And he does it through his word, through his power, through his spirit. And then he goes on to say, Romans 7:23 talks about how we serve God with our mind. It says we serve God with our mind. This is how we're going to get free, is by renewing our minds. Romans 8:5-6 talks about how to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So we're going to serve God with our mind by renewing our minds to what He said, to what His Word says. I'm speaking, I'm believing, I'm meditating on it. This is how I'm going to serve God. And it says in Romans 8:11, but if the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, that same Spirit will quicken your mortal body. The same Spirit lives on the inside of you. So you can't say, I can't do this no more, or it's just too hard. No, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives on the inside of you. God Almighty lives on the inside of you. And if you want Him to come out, you start by believing, speaking, and seeing His Word through the pages of it. Romans 8:15, God didn't give us the spirit of bondage to fear, but the spirit of adoption, where we cry out, Abba, Father. We cry out, Daddy, Daddy, you love me so much, I don't have to be bound. You love me so much, I don't have to live in the past. You love me so much, I cry out, Daddy, Daddy. In Romans 8:17, if we're children of God, then we're heirs of God. Joint heirs with Christ Jesus. In Romans 8:31, if God be for us, it doesn't matter who's against us. It doesn't matter the people that's against you. It doesn't matter. Our battle is not against people. It's against the principalities and powers of the world. And we cast them down, according to 2 Corinthians 10, by speaking the word of God, by believing in the promises of God, by renewing our minds to what His Word says. You are more than a conqueror. You can break those chains. You can walk free. You can live that John 10:10 abundant life that Jesus died to give us. And we do that by renewing our mind, by seeing, saying, and believing His promises. And that's how you'll start over. I'll come back up a minute. I'll be right after you.
Let's all stand.
Must Jesus
Jesus bear a cross all alone, and all the world go free. No. Cross for me, the consecrated cross I'll bear till death shall set me free. For there is a crown for me.
Jesus said to the disciples, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. We can't take the cross that Jesus did because he bore that at Calvary. But to take up our cross is to lay down our wants, our selfish desires, and our dreams and plans, and follow after Jesus. And if you've never made Jesus the Lord of your life, I'm going to give you that opportunity right now. Maybe you've walked away from God. Maybe, you know, if you die tonight, you do not know where you'd go, heaven or hell. You're not sure. Well, the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 2 that today is the day of salvation. You don't have to live in fear. You don't have to live in regret. You can start over today. So I'm going to ask everyone to bow their head. If you may have never made Jesus Lord of your life, I'm going to give you that opportunity right now. I'm going to ask you to step out, walk down the aisle, or if you've walked away from God and you want to return to God, this is your time. If you're tired of dealing with it, you don't want to live alone, deny yourself and follow after the Lord Jesus.
Upon the crystal pavement down at Jesus, at his pierced feet, joyful I will cast my His dear name repeat. Oh, precious cross, oh, glorious crown.